All right. Well, welcome to the first Medical Physics Journal Club. Today we're going to be talking about ethics. So this is the first journal club, the sort of maiden voyage. Running with this analogy, I thought it would be interesting to introduce the topic with a sort of gag. So imagine that that we're all of us are in a ship. We're sailing along, when all of a sudden, out of nowhere, we encounter an issue, a wild something. The ship is scuttled. We are all safely make it into the life raft, slowly drift away, and make it to relative safety. Now there's an issue. We don't have very much water. So the kind of question is, how do you fairly ration the water that we do have amongst all the individuals? So one method, which you may immediately think of, you may think to be the most fair method, is to do it equally, distribute the water equally, so each person gets the exact same amount of water. What if that isn't fair? What if water were distributed in proportion to the person's metabolism? So each person gets sort of a biologically equivalent amount of water. Maybe that's not fair. Maybe it's in proportion to the level of need, so the specific level of dehydration that an individual has. Some people will claim, or may claim, that seniority is an important factor. Or that anti-seniority, or the youngest first, the person who has, I guess, spent the least amount of their lives before this incident, should get the water. There's maybe a case to be had for past merit, so those who helped other individuals get onto the raft as soon as they could, or the most, somehow. There's also future merit. It might be advantageous to give more water to those who can fish. Maybe it's a good survival strategy. I don't know if it's fair. Maybe that's what your idea of fair is trying to find the optimal strategy to stay alive the longest. In a very grim situation, maybe it would be unlikely that everyone could survive. And so by distributing the water amongst several individuals, you would somehow doom everyone. Maybe fairness would be picking at least one person to survive. That might be fair. So really the question is, given these, is there actually a fair way to ration this water? So this is a sort of ethical dilemma, trying to figure out whether it's fair to ration this water. It's sort of another little bit of ethical dilemma, sort of anecdote, is I've heard, it's not certain or anything, but I've heard that in certain historical places, I believe India or something, the super rich elite would hire people to sweep bugs off the path in front of them so that they could feel ethically superior to those who would inevitably have to stop and look down or would just squish insects. And so there's, I don't know whether you consider that ethical or moral or whatever, that's sort of the core of the issue. So by the way, I'd actually like to know if you do think there's any fair way to ration the water. Maybe because I'm recording this, you could leave comments or something, figure out how to get the dialogue going in this format. The answer, I think, this is my idea, is that it's possible maybe. All the necessary condition is that everyone has to agree that it's fair. And then it's what we would call fair enough. I think that would be ethical if everyone were in agreement that it were fair enough. So this is not necessarily an ideal. This is just fair enough. So what really is ethics? What are we talking about here? Well, comparison with temperature. Temperature is measured with thermometers. We have a sort of hot and cold temperatures, and we can compare them. Ethics is a measure of morality. So, in other words, morality, values, principles, ideals. Again, we have right and wrong morals, and we can sort of compare them. It's important to note that temperature is objective, And ethics is subjective, so they're not the same thing. But the objectivity of temperature is even itself a little suspect. My wife and I disagree on what room temperature is. So ethics in medical physics. So we did this study on AAPM report, or sorry, we did this journal club meetings on report 159. So this is the primary resource. It gives a brief, super brief intro to the topics. Gives a list of recommendations, and it's basically what we'll hover around today. Another really core piece of material that you haven't studied yet, but I have, maybe we can share the info, is Report 109. It's the AAPM Code of Ethics. It gives concise descriptions of above topics, lots of great references, ethical complaint procedure. So in terms of other resources, there are really plenty. American College of Medical Physics, American College of Radiology, American Medical Association, U.S. Department of State even, so anywhere in between. I couldn't find anything with started with a Z, but there really are an enormous amount of resources for ethics. Let's talk about 159 though. So 159 is, in a nutshell, is that we are told to follow a code of ethics. As professionals, medical physicists must behave in an ethically sound manner, is what it says. We're not legally obligated to, but often we are expected to, and maybe even if we don't follow the code of ethics, grounds for removal of membership, grounds for termination of employment, etc. Maybe funding applications, etc. We really should not merely wing it, is what the core of this article says. It really argues about whether formal education in ethics is needed, should be mandatory or not. So we'll give you a quick tour of this. It starts right now. So let's take the historical, start with the historical stuff first. So Hippocrates lived a long time ago, 460 to 370 BC, ancient Greek physician. He's referred to as the father of Western medicine. Anyone know what his greatest feat was? Anyone? The real answer is that we honestly don't know. He was involved in creating a sort of ethos, or a dogma, maybe some kind of rules or guidelines around medicine that really revolutionized medicine and brought it to very close to what we kind of do today. But in terms of what he himself thought and did, and acted, how he acted, we really don't know. There are a few things that we do know about him and the people that surrounded him, some of his work. So here's a couple quotes. Hippocratic medicine was notable for its strict professionalism, discipline, and rigorous practice. The Hippocratic physician paid careful attention to all aspects of his practice. He followed detailed specifications for lighting, personnel, instruments, positioning of the patient, and techniques of bandaging and splinting. He even kept his fingernails to a precise length. It's noteworthy that in an era of gods and mythology and mysticism, there is not one mention of any kind of, I guess you would call, non-scientific aspects in any of the works that are accredited to Hippocrates or his followers. So he really kind of cast out the mystical aspects and just focused on disease and medicine in the sort of style that we practice today. So really the core bits of information about Hippocrates is this thing called the Hippocratic Corpus, which was probably compiled long after the Greeks were reduced, I guess by the Romans, or assimilated, and kind of the world moved on. So the Hippocratic Corpus is a collection of around 70 early medical works, including the Hippocratic Oath, which is widely thought to be the most important. And so this is the thing that concerns our ethics. So here's a rendering of the Hippocratic Oath in the shape of a cross. The Hippocratic Oath requires a new physician to swear upon a number of Greek healing gods to uphold specific ethical standards. So it really outlines a specific code of ethics. This was 2,500 years ago. So the Hippocratic Oath was the basis of the Declaration of Geneva. sort of interesting. Much later, along amongst other things, it really influenced a lot of other things, but this is kind of the thing that popped out to me the most. It really addressed the medical crimes committed in Nazi Germany and fixed this dubious loophole, or so it's referred to as, where the Nazi doctors believed the patients that they were experimenting on or murdering, killing, torturing, they thought that they were non-human, and so they thought that the Hippocratic Oath would somehow not apply. So the Declaration of Geneva really, it seems a little childish, but it really kind of filled these loopholes and really made sure that this sort of thing can never be interpreted in that same way again. So probably a widely known fact, but it's still administered to many medical students to this day when they graduate. There's some stats in the paper. American colleges, I think it's 99% swear to the Hippocratic Oath or a revised version of it. So really the Hippocratic Oath is a philosophical origin of almost all subsequent medical ethics. Even if not a direct lineage, kind of the core idea is there. So on to the next. So the paper mentions Thomas Percival and says that the code of ethics that we follow today more closely follows Thomas Percival's. So he was an English physician. He lived much, much later, 1740 to 1804. He coined the term medical ethics. So we didn't speak of medical ethics before this. And it really is the first sort of modern code of medical ethics. So a little bit of a story about how that got started. In 1792, a work stoppage by surgeons coincided with the outbreak of an epidemic. Now, the work stoppage by surgeons is interesting for a totally different, unrelated reason, because there were sort of, not warring groups, but bickering groups of surgeons that argued back and forth. And I won't get into that, but it's interesting if you hit up Wikipedia. Honestly, very funny anecdotes there. But anyways, so hospital trustees were absolutely outraged that desperate patients were being turned away from the hospital. So patients were being sent away. So in true English bureaucratic style, they called upon Percival to lead a committee to draft rules to prevent any recurrence of this fiasco. I find that absolutely hilarious that they called on him to draft rules and lead a committee. It just seems super... super bureaucratic to me. Anyways, landmark, very extremely important. In addition to that, he was widely regarded as just basically being a stand-up guy. He, for example, was involved in creating legislation that limited children's work days to 12 hours. So before Thomas Percival, work days were just as long as you could force children to work, which is just unbelievable. So, most significant contribution to Western medical ethical history subsequent to Hippocrates was made by Thomas Percival when, in 1803, he published his Code of Medical Ethics, rather. So this is a quote from, I believe, the... ACMP? Code of Ethics, I think? Anyways, it's given in the paper. So, the important bit is that Percival's code is substantially used today. Slight modifications, but that's basically where our code of ethics comes from. So since his time, there's been some notable events. 1847, the American Medical Association Code is published. 1958, AAPM Ethical Committee and Ethical Guidelines are established. Now, the guidelines are not a code, and the committee primarily deals with violations of ethics. So there's no official code, but there is sort of a framework in place. 1983, the ACMP committee is formed. I think they had, I think they may have had a code before then, but I don't know. Anyways, in 1997, Comp Code of Ethics is published, and let's see, about 10 years later, the AAPM official Code of Ethics is produced. So there are some unanswered questions that we'll talk about now. So ethics training is sort of the core of this paper, or report rather. So the question is, should formal ethics training be mandatory for all physicists? So we're not talking about medical physicists, we're talking about all physicists at this point. So there's a report linked in the paper, Ethics and the Welfare of Physics Profession, in 2004. The report focused on the American Physical Society, APS. Point here, younger members of the physics community have raised significant concerns about the treatment of subordinates and about other ethical issues. So the number of reported ethical issues or violations that were reported by junior members and department chairs, what do you guys think? So in terms of the number, percentage of people. So what about by junior members? 39% reported ethical violations or witnessing ethical violations or being being subject to these ethical violations or mishaps, rather. By department chairs, only 10%. So a substantial difference. Some really telling quotes here. So they mentioned particularly shocking was how often the words abuse and exploitation were used to describe the treatment of grad students. So some actual responses listed in that survey. Many breaches of ethics arise from the pressure to publish. Truthfully, grad school's purpose is to provide cheap, talented labor to get science done cheaply. And our scientific community promotes a search of the surface and superficiality to the detriment of content and deepness. In the same port, there were a few other issues raised. So in 2002, there was a timely event that the physics community was rocked by two highly publicized cases of data fabrication. Perhaps we should be doing more to promote ethics. Then there was some other, I won't say naysayers, but they were thinking about whether formal training would do anything. So the first one says, I seriously question whether or not ethics training can help some people. The second one said, the importance of ethical behavior is likely to be learned or not learned far earlier than professional training as a physicist. So those are two important points when trying to think about whether this training should be a formal requirement for all physicists. The same report listed the number of ethics, not infractions, but violations, I guess you would say, by type. And so there's no kind of overwhelming category. Data falsification, not including appropriate authors, plagiarism, and less than truthful reports are the biggest quadrants or sectors. So that's interesting. So not really a cut and dry answer for all physicists. What about for medical physicists? We're somehow more involved directly with patients. We're an extremely collaborative field, interdisciplinary field. So this was debated in 2003, linked in this in the report we're looking at. So the folks that on the four positions said that all should have a specific course on ethics. So this is one of their arguments. They also said it is not enough that each of us individually tries his or her best to practice ethical behavior. This is actually a quote inside the paper. Against were the points that Mother Teresa did not take a course on ethics. And then they also give an example about reviewing resumes. Would you prefer a course on IMRT or ethics if you're hiring somebody, kind of as a trade-off? If one person has IMRT versus if the person has ethics course, which would you hire? Frankly, in my opinion, neither of these arguments is very convincing, especially this against position. Mother Teresa's obviously... We're not all, obviously, Mother Teresa, and the point is very far out there, especially for a leading point. The second of all, this reviewing resumes, well, I think there's some kind of kernel of truth there. They really present this false dichotomy between having a course in IMRT, which you would expect or require, compared to having a course in ethics. Really, the comparison should have been a person with an ethics course and a person not with an ethics course, not necessarily a trade-off, because the ethics course is going to be a lot shorter than IMRT, and IMRT, I think, in a clinical setting, is very crucial, certainly crucial to have. So really, I think this debate was not very entertaining. It only got three citations, and I think this report cited was one of the citations, rather. So here's a discussion point. What do you think? Should the UBC administer formal mandatory ethics training? Let me know. State your case. We'll have get a little bit of feedback here. So onward, how does UBC compare? In 2009, 61 graduate and residency programs surveyed. So a survey of 61 grad and residency programs, I believe throughout America. So note, this was only 1 year after the Code of Ethics was actually published. So not a lot of turnaround time to throw an ethics course into the curriculum. But nonetheless, approximately 50% offer a formal course. The grad course lengths and the residency course lengths are different. Now the mean and median, the mean is always higher than the median by roughly a factor of two, and the mean itself is usually quite low, 11 hours versus roughly 6 hours. So this is a very small portion over the 2 years or 4 years of a master's or PhD, or 2 years of a residency. But really, with the mean and the median in this arrangement, this distribution, the number of programs, kind of like a histogram, versus the length of the course, is really skewed to one side. So if there is a class, it's very short. In this case, the median would be around here, and the mean would be around here, which would be weighted by that long tail. Of course, this is just for the number of courses that have an ethics program, or ethics course. The number of courses that, or the number of programs that have no ethics course would strongly weight this to zero length. So this is what the real distribution looks like. Really, either not very much class time or no class time at all. Maybe a handful with a real meaty, long, substantial ethics course. So UBC is sort of normal in that regard. So the paper also gets some recommendations. TG report also gets some recommendations. They're very clear cut. They recommend 15 to 30 hours of formal ethical instruction. They recommend you take this once, either in grad school or during residency. They say the format is very flexible, but the instruction should be explicit and highly structured. And then they give specific detailed curricula of what exactly should be taught or learned or experienced or whatever. I think this is really nice. They really lay it out for you. So just a couple notes. Just digging around, from a BCCA residency posting in December of 2013, there was a quote that said, "There's an expectation to adhere to the professional code of ethics developed by the Canadian College of Physics in Medicine." So this is an expectation for residency position, which a student may or may not have had a course in. The PHSA has specific policies that lay out expectations and govern our behavior, including code of ethics, research conflict of interest, standards of business conduct, and there's also a whistleblower policy, if you didn't know. This was mentioned in the paper, the report. It said, we encourage CAMPEP to verify the programs require an ethics course. So they don't require it, but they may, maybe soon in the future, will. So on a personal note, I personally think it would be interesting and useful to take an ethics course. Like Sir Francis Bacon says, knowledge is power. The time commitment would be very small, and frankly, I think it would just be useful. So ethics, specific points of interest. I don't have time to go over all of ethics. That would take about 15 to 30 hours. But let's talk about a little bit of somehow fun stuff. This is what came up when I Googled fun. It sort of looks fun, I guess. So in AAPM report number 109, this is the official code of ethics document, which I would say is very readable and interesting. It's also worth just a quick peek, even on your ride home if you take transit today. Perfect thing to just crack open on the bus. Very to the point and simplified. Simple language, simple English, and interesting. So here's a reference. So let's do a quick quiz. So promotional items, this is from report number 109. These are questions I've gleaned from the material. Promotional items, educational items, and modest gifts less than $100 are acceptable or not acceptable? What do you think? They are acceptable. Tickets for sporting events are acceptable or not acceptable? They're not acceptable. It specifically says in the AAPM Code of Ethics that this is not acceptable. So what about tickets to a concert or a play that are less than $100? Acceptable or not acceptable? They're not acceptable. What about being provided tickets whilst being accompanied to a recreational event? So this is kind of getting a little convoluted, but it's a real-world situation. So think like a corporate skybox at a hockey game or something. Do you think that would be acceptable or not acceptable? Certainly, skyboxes are very common in industry. Not in medical physics. They should not be accepted. They're not acceptable. So what are some of the ethical obligations involved in vacating the position? So when you finish your job, if you're a student or a resident, or if you're moving positions, what sort of ethical obligations do you have in this transition? Pause the video. So here are a few. This is not totally inclusive. These are listed in the TG report, Code of Ethics, but there's some other ones that I feel are kind of important or just necessary. But first, the big one is leaving all info for which compensation was received. So make sure that you've done your job, you've done it well, and that the info that you were paid to do isn't somehow lost or disappears with you. You know, this is really, you were hired to do a job, make sure that the job is done. When you leave. Make a reasonable effort to facilitate the transition, so basically just helping the new person that will fill your shoes, or helping the staff. Provide legible, orderly documentation. So this is separate from point A. Point C really asks you to clearly spell out to a person who may have to fill your shoes exactly what the situation is. I think that's really important. The last one is to honor intellectual property agreements, especially laws. This isn't legally binding, of course, but laws are, and intellectual property rights are a very large field of law. So there are more, but I think kind of the key others are providing reasonable advance notice, respecting research data ownership agreements, especially when you're collaborating with other individuals, and really it's not explicitly stated, but following the code of ethics as per normal, whether or not you're employed still. So let's say the day after your last day, you somehow have to come in and work a few things out. Maybe you're finishing up documentation or something. Even though you're still not, you're technically not employed, you really are still required to follow the code of ethics. Not legally, but just in terms of the other ramifications of not following the code of ethics. So here's an interesting one, maybe timely with the Snowden fiasco and Bradley, Chelsea Manning. In medical physics, in the AAPM Code of Ethics, is whistleblowing allowed? Is this something that the field permits? Yes, it absolutely is. Are whistleblowers granted immunity through the Code of Ethics? It's permitted. Are they granted immunity? No, they're not. Are whistleblowers necessarily respected by the Code of Ethics? So does the Code of Ethics necessarily tell you to respect whistleblowers? The answer is yes. So these questions I feel a little bit easy, so we'll crank up the difficulty a little bit, kind of get to the meat of the ethics. These are pulled from the first source. So, should the person who secures funding automatically be listed as a co-author? What do you think? Yes or no? To tell you the truth, I don't know. Comp The Comp Code of Ethics gives no explicit comments on the matter that I've seen. AAPM authorship is strictly merit-based, so conception and design, analysis, drafting, and revising, co-authorship, necessarily a person needs to participate in each of these categories. So whether or not conception is somehow related to securing funding, certainly securing funding, you have to submit some sort of kind of research plan, is sort of up to you. Whether or not the person fits this criteria really is up to you. Certainly if they just satisfy this and have no part of the other pieces, then I would say no. They are not automatically listed as a co-author. The American Physical Society sort of skirts the issue. It says, although statements are very clear that authorship of a paper must be earned, the statements are non-specific. So they really leave it up to you to be very flexible. So here's another question. Must every co-author in an interdisciplinary collaboration understand and vouch for every detail in the paper? What do you think? If you are a co-author, should you have every detail in the paper at your grasp? The answer, again, is I don't know. Do you? Maybe do you have any ideas? Does that seem fair? Is it reasonable? Are all co-authors responsible when one of them has violated personal ethics in the published work? So, if there are 10 co-authors, and it comes to light, maybe a year later, that one of the persons has falsified data, or their piece of the analysis, yada yada yada, is everyone on the author list responsible? Yes or no? Again, it's unclear. There's no yes or no answer, as far as I can tell. Certainly, you should be aware of the competency of the people you're co-authoring with, but it's just unrealistic all the time to check everything everyone else has done. So really, you have to be really integrated into the procedure of co-authorship and publishing in order to get any sort of sensible answer out of this. So some specific incidents we'll quickly talk about. Just on a whim, I checked UBC ethics incident, and this post on Reddit came up, and it's the UBC subreddit, and the fellow is asking, or the individual is asking, is there a publicly viewable code of conduct / ethics for UBC faculty? And they say, I have a friend who's being unfairly treated by a professor and is being disregarded, i.e. form letter response without even a name, by the administration. So this person believes their friend is being wronged by not only the supervisor or a professor, but the administration at large, asking for some points. And so the response is, I think this is interesting. So these sorts of things do happen at UBC. So there's a link to the AMS Advocacy Office, and then especially the Ombuds Office, which I would recommend if you were in the situation. So from the second link, or the second reference rather, quote, the Ethics Committee of the AAPM has dealt with issues of acknowledgement of corporate support for research work, review of others' work, and several other unnamed topics, and issued formal statements. They go on to say disputes have occurred between medical physicists who could have been served by a formal ethics course, and it's a conflict, heartache, and even animosity could have been averted. So this is clearly in favor of a formal requirement, ethical coursework. Also from two, this is the point-counterpoint paper. My inquiry with the past and current chairs of the Ethics Committee indicates the yearly number of ethical cases has remained flat and may be decreasing. They want to say approximately one case per year potentially requires action. And just for scale, there are roughly 5,000 AAPM members. This one case per year is between AAPM members. So that's a fairly low rate. It's non-zero, but it's fairly low. A later study in 2013, I think this was in 2004 or so, but about 10 years later, another AAPM study, also on the AAPM member corpus, showed that greater than or equal to 40% of members reported observing frequent unethical or ethically questionable practices. So that's quite a difference. One case per year potentially requires action, yet 40% or more members reported observing some unethical behavior. Maybe there's more violations happening than formal complaints. So maybe it is an issue. It's sort of hard to tell from this. So here's an unrelated event. It's kind of interesting, a familiar manuscript. So a manuscript was submitted for publication to a medical physics journal, and during the review process, one of the referees was astounded to realize that this was an exact reproduction of a paper he had himself published some years before in a different journal. Just astonishing to me. I believe the person who tried to submit underwent some ethical review. They were barred from publishing in the journal and was, of course, declined. But such a brazen attempt at plagiarism is certainly unethical. So there really aren't any high-profile cases that immediately spring to mind, and it's a little bit difficult to search these. Why is that? Well, it turns out the confidentiality of reported violations and investigations is actually prescribed in the Code of Ethics. So there is a little bit of, difficulty in this information seeping out. There are some resources online that I couldn't find anything, some medical physics incidents have occurred surrounding maybe or resulting from unethical behavior or ethical violations, but nothing really that screams out. So, not in medical physics, but in the medical profession, there's a famous case with a lethal injection. So, in 1991, a fellow was set to be executed in Georgia. So, the execution team could not gain access to this fellow's veins due to extreme drug use. So, they brought in a doctor who was an expert at finding deep veins in the human body. This is interesting because patients involved in executions are brought in as consultants. In this case, once the doctor was hired for the sole reason of inserting an IV, the doctor became part of the execution team in terms of classification. So another group of doctors, or a group of doctors rather, sued the Georgia State Medical Board for not disciplining the doctor, stating that he violated federal law and thus broke the Hippocratic Oath that he took earlier. I don't know the outcome of this for the particular doctor, but I do know that laws regarding the oaths that doctors take, rather, and the specific types of behavior they're allowed to engage in, especially involving things like abortion and assisted suicide and lethal injection, capital punishment, have been altered because of this case specifically. So that's about it. Ethics definitely plays a role in medical physics for sure. Whether or not we've conclusively decided whether instruction of ethics should be mandatory is kind of up in the air, I guess. If you have any comments, please let me know. Please share them. All right. Thanks for participating. There are a whole bunch of future topics that are available if somebody wants to jump in and present on one, or if they have any other suitable topics, that would be also fantastic. Thanks a lot.